So section 8403 says taxation without notice. Costs may also be taxed without notice. A party who has taxed costs without notice shall immediately serve a copy of the bill of costs upon each party who is entitled to notice under section 8402. Within 5 days after such service, any such party may serve notice of retaxation of costs upon 5 days' notice to the party who has taxed the costs, specifying the item as to which retaxation is sought. Strickland failed to serve notice within 5 days after such service of retaxation of costs. Strickland should have gone to the judgment clerk, not to Judge Silverman. Judge Silverman should never have signed February 1st, 1995, any such order to show cause, his third, that is anti-Glendora and pro-Cablevision. Strickland writes, the bill of costs is erroneous. This affidavit shall serve as defendant's notice of retaxation. Glendora writes, this is lazy. This is insufficient. This is unacceptable. She's throwing in an order to show cause and a notice of retaxation. The bill of costs, Glendora says, judgment and execution were posted to Kalaji Strickland the same day that the sheriff got them. This is more civil, quote unquote, than Strickland, who got the order to show cause, Rob number two, to Glendora on Sunday, February the 5th at 5 p.m., but got it to Judge Silverman and the sheriff on February the 1st, 5 days earlier. She had plenty of time, Strickland, that is, to get in a retaxation of costs, but Judge Silverman is her boy. He will sign any order to show cause and temporary restraining order, any. This is the third one. Chief Judge Ingrassia won't sign temporary restraining orders with the alacrity Judge Silverman does. No sensible judge will. Judge Silverman should put his foot down and do his job once in a while. Strickland writes, the bill of costs is erroneous in part because it awards $495 in disbursements. Pursuant to CPLR Section 8302C, plaintiff is not entitled to disbursements because the court did not order costs or disbursements, and because plaintiff, who was seeking $181 million in damages, did not recover the sum of $50 or more. See copy of this court's corrected decision and order annexed hereto as Exhibit D. And Glendora writes to that, Judge Silverman was wrong not to order costs and disbursements. Glendora has appealed this inequity to the appellate division. Besides, Glendora gets costs and disbursements because Judge Silverman was silent on same. Judge Silverman was wrong not to award $181 million damages, and Glendora has appealed this part of his decision order to the appellate division. Judge Silverman was wrong not to award Glendora any damages at all, also on appeal. Judge Silverman was wrong not to order $50 damages, also on appeal. So CPLR 8302C does not apply. Strickland writes, even if plaintiff was entitled to disbursements, which she is not, some, if not all, of the disbursements she lists, such as fee for index number, are not recoverable under the provisions of CPLR Section 8301, to which Glendora answers, oh, yes, they are. The judgment clerk went over Glendora's bill of costs in detail. He approved everything. If Strickland had gone to the judgment clerk instead of to the judge, who doesn't know costs as well as the clerk, she would have been on the right track instead of this wrong one. Strickland is puerile. Her legal papers are all infantile. Strickland writes, moreover, it is respectfully submitted that plaintiff is not a prevailing party as defined in CPLR sections 8101 and 8103, entitled to costs at all, since she prevailed on only one cause of action and her remaining eight causes of action were dismissed by the court. And Glendora writes to this, this is nonsense. If Glendora is not a prevailing party, why did Judge Silverman say three times on July 14, 1994, 10:20 a.m., it's over. You win. It's over. You win. You didn't win money, he said, but you won something much more important. That's what Judge Silverman said. Why did Judge Silverman say twice that same day, you didn't win money, but you won something more important than money? If that isn't prevailing party, quote unquote, what is? And Judge Silverman was wrong dismissing Glendora's remaining eight causes of action, as Glendora has shown the appellate division. Two of them he ruled collateral estoppel on the basis of Judge Bryant's decision, and this decision has been vacated by the United States Court of Appeals Second Circuit. Here comes more infantile stuff from Strickland. In any event, this court, in its equitable powers, should deny plaintiff recovery of any costs and disbursements due to the egregious manner in which he has conducted this litigation at every turn. What has that got to do with the fact that it is a law that I'm entitled to costs? What has that got to do with it? This is how infantile Strickland is, and Kalaji, and Stevens, Satterley, Burke, and Burke. Glendora writes, take a look at egregious manner. Cablevision defendants broke two laws. New York State Executive Law, Article 28, Section 829.3, and Title 47 of the United States Code, Section 531E, no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. That's not egregious enough. How is that for?
This is the log, and you have heard it up through Wednesday. Okay, now let me read it to you. Wednesday afternoon, I went up to Yorktown, Cablevision, and edited. Carl Pagano has a great system up there, and Gary is very helpful and cheerful, and we did the job. Edited about four programs up there that had been videotaped on Wednesday. And then on Thursday, four more programs were videotaped. This is 8 half-hour programs in 1 week. That is a record, and it's a terrible thing. That's too many things to have happen in a week. And we videotaped the wall law breaking from December 1st to December 7th. And I went to the second Advent service at church. We have a service at noon, and then we have a luncheon at 12:30 p.m., and two people from TCI went with me. That would be Lizanne Powers and Adele. Lizanne. New Year's Day, January the 1st, 1995, Sunday, and the time is 4 p.m. And the days are getting longer and longer. Oh, that's nice.
The morning of January the 3rd, 1995, Tuesday, I opened the door and discovered this torn-up log, plus a copy of Grounds for Eviction to John Porzio, Grounds for Eviction of Walt and Al Pucci. The person who did it remains anonymous. Some of it is on the stairs going up to the Walsh apartment. At 7 a.m., Franklin distributed the log to 13 apartments. Excuse me, to 13 apartments. This would be one of those. It was made is 8:40 a.m. January 3rd, 1995, Tuesday.
Now, folks,
the box in our locker, our basement bin, there's about 7 columns, and maybe 6, and there's about 8 rows, no, maybe 5 rows, and the box on the bottom of one of the columns was because of all the weight, because it's heavy files, and it was a 1989 file box, and so we took the box out and then put in a brand new box. 7 a.m. there was more noise from across the hall. I found the green sock and the navy sock, and two cars were parked in 3B again. You saw that on videotape, and it is not fair. The noisy 3B car made 16 maneuvers in parking area and with a noisy radio. And at 9:45 a.m. Sunday morning, New Year's morning, I videotaped the two cars in one space. And at 9:45 a.m., Roberta blew her horn twice under our dining room window. And there was a cigarette smoke in the hall. And that's very, very bad, because secondhand cigarette smoke is terrible for a person to inhale and dangerous to his health. At 8:03 p.m., there were 6 horn blasts. This is on New Year's Day. 6 horn blasts by Daniel Walsh as he drove the red truck into the yard under our dining room window. And when Daniel Walsh went by the door of Glendora, he mocked, "Glendora, hurrah, and Roberta slapped Glendora's door, apartment door, and activated the door knocker. They must have been under the influence of some substance, because normal people just do not act that way. The second petition, which I read to you last week, to John Porzio to evict James, Roberta, and Daniel Walsh, and Nella, and around about 6 a.m., that took a quarter of an hour. It took an hour yesterday to print the wall log, yesterday, Monday, and the cost was $5.40. Franklin also put out a reduced version of the John Porzio petition, the petition to John Porzio to evict Walsh and Ampucci. And the Glendora has decided to up the damages and make an amended complaint and increase the damages to $21,000 per family because it was $7,000 as of November the Armistice Day, 1993. But since they have continued the breaking of the laws and continued the injuries, I think they were about 700 to 800 tortious acts when the lawsuit was filed, and now it's doubled since they don't have the sense, the common sense, to stop and live as they should live. The damages are going to be increased to $21,000 on the Walsh family, $21,000 on the Alpucci family, and $21,000 on the Larkin family for all that the lying, cheating Larkin lawyers are putting Glendora through. 7:12 a.m., the wall log was torn into 30 or so pieces on the floor. I showed you that on videotape between apartments 1A and 2A. Prime suspect would be Daniel Walsh. Here is the certificate of readiness for trial. If Judge Wood, the No Good Wood Court, if he should be signing that and getting this thing on its way to the calendar clerk to schedule a trial, it'll be a year even there sitting in the calendar clerk's office. So you try to find justice in these crooked courts, you're just not going to. Here are a.m. lawbreaking. Daniel Walsh parks his car across the sidewalk, causing to go into the road. The city of White Plains can be sued for that if the police don't come and do something about it. That's Tortious Act number 1643. The person who was too cowardly, whoever tore up the log, and whatever person had it strewn all about the hallway, was too cowardly to own up to doing it. We will have to put names on the logs to block cowardly anonymity. Franklin notarized the grounds to evict on Tuesday, and it was served on everybody. BRS, who is a lawyer, and RP, who is a lawyer, we talked about increasing the damages to $21,000 per family. The Walshes were gone all day Tuesday. The mess is still in the front hall. The UPS man was reading a piece of it as he was delivering a package. The wall postage now costs $7. And we had to get new stamps, and the line was way out past the post office counters and into the post office lobby. That was true of the White Plains Post Office and the Scarsdale Post Office. It's just terrible the way they make people pay. We are now up to Wednesday, and the broken up log, torn up log is still all over the front hall. It looks terrible for anybody who comes in here. And we have here a police report. And this police report is written by Officer Eric Fisher, and it's about an event of December the 21st, 1994. The report taken over the phone, the complainant called and reported on the above date, time, and location. I can't read the writing. While the complainant was walking into her building, she heard Nala Alpucci of Building C know it's Building B laughing loudly. Complainant felt this was aimed at her and was done to harass her. But the time of this was not 5:10 p.m., it was 3:10 p.m. And it wasn't Building C, it was Building B. Here is another couple of police reports. This report is about something that happened on December the 20th, 1994. The report is 2 pages. Report taken over the phone. Complainant reports on the above date, time, and place while she entered her building. Something, an incident with a youth on roller skates, that would be James Walsh, that Daniel Walsh came out of the above building and frightened the complainant, and something, and stated, you'd better run to your door. Complainant then stated Roberta Walsh, then came down the stairs and screamed at the complainant, pushed her and slapped her on the head. Complainant stated she that Roberta Walsh also pulled complainant's hat off and threw it to the floor. The complainant stated she received no injuries during this. Altercation. No further incident was reported. This is number 43. I don't know what that means. Thursday, F534HN license number blows horn every morning at 8:30 a.m. It snowed a trifle on Wednesday. The temperature, other than that, has been 50 degrees. Marvelous for January and December. Porzio was here for 2 minutes and went into B. At 5:20 p.m. on Thursday, Nella noisy exhaust, air pollution and noise pollution. I videotaped it and I edited and I videotaped and edited Wall on Thursday. There was a torn up wall log again in the hallway of apartment building A since last night around 5:30 p.m. It stayed there all night Thursday. At 7:30 p.m., Marianne picked it up when cleaning the hall. My prime suspect on that, of course, is Daniel Walsh, and a very low level of citizenship. At 3:45 p.m., Roberta Walsh blasted her horn twice under Glendora's dining room window. That's a violation of the noise ordinance, also a vehicle and traffic law violation. A horn is to prevent accidents. A violation of the noise ordinance also, and it was harassment intent to annoy and alarm. So that was 6 tortious acts. At 10:48 p.m., Nella Alpucci went by Glendora's south bedroom window. Now this is at 10:48 p.m., almost 11 o'clock, and called, "Hi Glendora, how are you?" And then she banged her fist on Glendora's window twice. So that's harass, emotional disturbance, and motion, harass, emotional disturbance, and White Plains noise ordinance. The mess of the wall log was cleaned up by when she cleaned the halls and cellars, and she left a scrub brush in the cellar. So I put it away in a safe place where she would see it and be able to retrieve it. This is the certificate of readiness for trial. Cellar. So he deliberately turns around and he comes down the cellar steps and he comes into the cellar deliberately. And he said, and he crossed through the cellar and started out the east door. And he said, "Have you sent out any letters lately?" And of course, we said nothing to him. We will not speak to him, and we haven't spoken to him for a year and 8 months, I believe it is. Because things are bad enough, and if you ever spoke to him, that would be more fights. Have you sent out any letters lately? And we said nothing. He said as he crossed the cellar going east toward the east door. That was a nice one you sent out the other day. We said nothing. He exited the east door of the cellar. He went up the stairs, headed north. He turned east to go along the sidewalk, and then he turned south to go toward the field, and then he turned west to go out the driveway, which is where he was headed in the first place. He must have been on something. Normal people do not act that way. He just cannot learn to leave us alone. He went all the way out of his way to do this. Three intentional inflictions of emotional disturbance, three insulting and abusive language, three harass, annoy, and disturb with no legitimate purpose. He was trying to start a fight. So there, that's why we don't talk to him. So there is another report for TV as Karamitsu whines the defendants are complaining that these reports are on TV and that they are the topic of conversation and they are the topic of jests. Well, okay, the answer to that is cause and effect. What causes them to be on TV? Breaking the law and harassing us and intentionally inflicting emotional disturbance. That's what causes them on TV. If they don't want to be on TV, then stop it. And that's the way it's been for a year and 11 months. So every time they do it, that's a cause, and the effect is a report in print and on TV. At 6 p.m., James Walsh, his son, did the same thing his father did at 6 a.m. Sunday. At 6 p.m. Sunday, James Walsh, the son, did the same thing that his father did at 6 a.m. Sunday. Like father, like son. James whistles. That's against the White Plains noise ordinance, and roller skated under our south bedroom window from the southwest corner of our apartment, just from our apartment, to the southeast corner of our apartment for 45 minutes. So that's number 45 times 3 equals 135 tortious acts. He too was trying to pick a fight. He gave up at 6:45 p.m. and went upstairs where he belongs. At 9 a.m., Francisco and 2A gave Glendora a boost on the Lincoln. I went over to ask him for a boost. Let's see, at 1:29 p.m. Saturday, November the 28th, Glendora is working hard at her desk, a voice artificially high from the front hall of Building A shouts, "Glendora!" It was James Walsh. Glendora went to the door. James was exiting the front door. Roberta was behind him. Glendora stood at her door and saw them. Roberta turned around and said truculently, "And what is your problem?" Glendora said nothing before, during, or after. James went toward their red truck. Roberta said to him, "What did you do?" James broke four laws: abusive and insulting language, intentional infliction of emotional disturbance, harash, shouting, hollering, and hooting, so as to disturb the quiet, peace, comfort, and health of any person in any dwelling or residence. Oh yeah, here's a dumb thing by James Walsh. On the 5th of February, 1995, Sunday, at 6 p.m., James Walsh rapped at his kitchen window at us. He lives on the second floor and he sits at the kitchen window and he watches us work on the Lincoln, getting the salt and the slush off with hot water. And it was 19 degrees and when he rapped on the window, I heard him but I ignored him. And he was, and then I came into the Building A and started in my apartment. And he was so frustrated that I had ignored his rapping on the window that he went out into the hall and screeched. That's sick. That's grounds for eviction. That's really sick. Just can't leave us alone. Six telephone books that were dropped in Building A. Whoever dropped off those telephone books for 9X ought to be fired. They dropped about 24 telephone books in the front hall of this building instead of taking the four for the tenants in Building B, the four for the tenants in Building C, and the four for the tenants in Building D. So they just piled up here in the front hall, making a mess. We took care of ours. I don't think the other people in this building took care of theirs. So we took the allotment to Building B, and they were very, very happy. And we took the allotment to Building C, and we took the allotment to Building D. It wasn't fair to the people in those buildings because they didn't even know they had telephone books. So we did our good deed there. Franklin was in the county courthouse, and somebody said to him, Wilson is a bad law firm. Wilson, Babe, Conboy, Cousins, all those names. I just...
Let's do a comedy show.
This is 2B and 3C.
No, that's a good joke. This is March the 26th, 1995. Sunday, Glendora was on her way to church when she came out to the front door and was assaulted and attacked and abused by Daniel. Well, what he said, I can't tell you, it was too obscene. But I was walking by. Did you see that?
Yeah, you were just walking by. Yeah.
I was just walking by. He rolled down. His window was rolled down, and he started a cascade of abuse and insults.
Right.
And so, and with James too. And
he was laughing derisively and snickering and trying to get James to do it, and I just stood there and watched them, and they got foolisher and foolisher, okay, and more embarrassed.
Right.
And they kept it up for how many minutes, would you say?
I don't know.